from the Weather Channel, a special presentation. Earthquakes, one of nature's most frightening phenomena. What causes an earthquake? And what can we do to protect our homes, to protect our lives when we find ourselves on shaky ground?
Imagine your world suddenly turned upside down, literally. The sidewalk buckles under your feet. Your house is flattened. What was dry land moments ago is now the bed of a wildly flowing river.
That's what can happen in an earthquake. Pretty scary, huh? This is an attraction called Earthquake, the big one, at Universal Studios Hollywood in California. It simulates an earthquake of 8.3 on the Richter scale with special effects. Very good special effects, but movie magic nonetheless. But imagine the terror if it were real, not just special effects. It's your street, your city, your life.
You're about to go on a tour of the two most earthquake-prone areas of the United States. One, California, will come as no surprise. Slicing the state from north to south, the San Andreas Fault makes its temblors felt from the desert east of Los Angeles to the Northern California wine country. The other is less widely known, Memphis, Tennessee. That's right, Memphis, just a few miles from what may be America's most dangerous fault, the New Madrid. We're going to show you what measures are being taken to protect life and property if and when the big one comes. And we're going to show you what happened, both before the cameras and behind the scenes, when a major earthquake struck the San Francisco area on October 17th of this year. But first, a very basic question. Why do earthquakes happen?
Behind me is the Golden Gate Bridge. And the city of San Francisco, at a distance, somewhere behind all that fog, it is a beautiful sight and a familiar one to many. People come from around the world to see it. Well, these people may not realize that this bit of real estate they've traveled so far to see has been doing some traveling of its own.
The surface of the earth is made up of about 8 or 9 large plates. And by plates, I mean the outer 40 to 60 miles of the Earth's surface. It's a little bit thinner underneath.
On a windy day in San Francisco, I talked with Dr. David Howell of the U.S. Geological Survey.
And these plates then are moving independent of each other.
Dr. Howell specializes in plate tectonics, the study of how the continents, the jigsaw-like outer surface of our planet, drift over millions of years.
300 million years ago was an exciting time for all of the global continents because it seems now that we have very good evidence to indicate that they were all joined together in one large clot.
The evidence Dr. Howell speaks of comes from the related study of paleomagnetism. Rocks contain magnetic particles that align with the North Pole when the rock hardens out of molten lava. By drilling plugs of solid rock from the California coast, and measuring the direction and angle of the magnetic alignment, scientists who study paleomagnetism, paleomagicians as Dave Howell calls them, can tell where a particular layer of rock originally formed and how far it has traveled.
Continental crust is so thick and moves so slowly that the heat beneath it comes up and gradually weakens it, and eventually it fragments. We had this complete connection of all the land masses as we know today, 300 million years ago. And then, beginning about 200 to 180 million years ago, it began to break apart. And you can sort of look at a map and see how Africa and South America fit together, and then the northern part of Africa fits right up into North America.
Many of the world's earthquakes are caused by the process of subduction. As one plate drifts over another, one continent is pushed down or subducted beneath the other. As the two masses grind together, friction and heat are generated. Often the two plates stick and tension builds along the fault line. When the tension is released, we feel it as an earthquake. But the movement that causes the temblors most often felt in California is of a slightly different nature. rather than one passing over the other. The North American plate and the Pacific plate meet at California's San Andreas Fault, where they grind past one another. As with subduction, as the plates pass, they often stick. And when they finally let go, California can get a strong jolt. Just 2 weeks before the October 17th quake, we visited the U.S. Geological Survey in Menlo Park, California, where seismologists monitor the fault 24 hours a day.
Well, what it's showing is earthquakes that have occurred since 1978 along the San Andreas, and those are the red and yellow dots that you see here. The blue dots are the earthquakes that occurred off the San Andreas, primarily the Coalinga earthquake and aftershocks back in 83.
The San Andreas Fault, over 600 miles long. It cuts through California like a giant surgical scar, in most places plunging below the surface where it's invisible to all but the best trained eye, and in other places making its presence graphically clear.
We've already identified the fault zones where earthquakes are a regular feature. Now, the real challenge is understanding the timing sequence that produces earthquakes regularly over geologic time. And if we understand that well enough, then it's a short step to prediction.
And that short step to prediction means a short side trip here. Welcome to Earthquake Central. This is Parkfield, California. Population 34. The San Andreas Fault runs right through here. Parkfield is a town full of ironies. It may seem to be a small town in the middle of nowhere, but when it comes to the science of earthquake prediction, Parkfield is the biggest town in America. What makes the Parkfield site so unique?
Right. Since 1857, we've had five earthquakes there. They're about the same size. They come at regular intervals. This is the only place on Earth we know of where we get earthquakes of this size. At magnitude 6, it's just big enough to be interesting. It's big enough that we really think it forms a scale model for really large earthquakes. They come every 22 years, so it's just sort of a made-to-order earthquake prediction experiment.
If you visit Parkfield today, you'll find the largest assortment of earthquake monitoring equipment in the world. Since they don't know what changes might precede a quake, changes in groundwater level, magnetic fields, some studies even suggest the Earth transmits radio signals. The Parkfield scientists gather as much information as possible, hoping it will become clear after the quake. Dwayne Hammond teaches, during the day, in one of the last one-room schoolhouses left in California. But at night, he mans the two-color laser, a state-of-the-art measuring device set up by the U.S. Geological Survey to check how far the plates have moved each week. On the day we visited, Dwayne was conducting a tour for a group of Chinese scientists.
The data that we gather is based on 20 measurements. And if I see that something's moving, I'll take 40 different measurements. And then from that, we take a standard deviation, and we get our distance by averaging those 20 or 40.
How long do you think it will be before you will be able to predict earthquakes as well as we are able to predict the weather?
I tell people, look, you see how accurate weather prediction is, and you can see what you're dealing with. We're dealing with something we can't really see, and we're trying to get down there as deep as we can, but that's a problem. So we're in the pioneering stages here. Let's hope we can find something.
When we come back, we'll look at some new buildings that are designed to roll with the punches.
Now for the first time on television, SMI's fantastic free cassette offer. The convenient condensation of Napoleon Hill's classic motivational masterwork, Think and Grow Rich. Call now. It's absolutely free. 1-800-452-7700. You'll gain self-confidence, improve your concentration, stimulate your subconscious, generate your imagination, master procrastination, multiply your brain power, turn your desires into reality. You will literally think and grow rich. Why does SMI make this amazing offer? Because people who are interested in Think and Grow Rich and other personal development materials are often the same people who are interested in knowing about SMI International's total line of programs and the unique business opportunity we offer. What do you have to lose? Call 1-800-452-7700 and start to think and grow rich.
We'll continue with On Shaky Ground with Cindy Preszler in just a minute. This program will be repeated this evening at 11 o'clock. Now it's time for your local forecast.
Weather Guide calendar and the Weather Folklore calendar are now available. Call toll-free to order yours. Just $8.95 each plus $3 shipping and handling per order. Call now.
Perhaps someday we'll find a foolproof way to predict where and how hard the next quake will hit. But even then, we'll be challenged to design and build structures that can withstand the shock. Don Clyde accepts that challenge here, amid the electrical buzz and hum of machinery at the Earthquake Engineering Research Center of the University of California at Berkeley.
This is a seismic isolation device. It's a rubber bearing. It's made up of laminated sections of rubber and steel. You can see this is a cross-section of it here where it's been cut through. In a building, one of these would go under each column of the building and it would support the vertical dead load of the building. So then it's the job of the seismic isolator to absorb this energy to keep the building from having to take on the full motion here.
Because of the almost daily quakes, California has had strict building codes for years. Now, base isolators are just one of the many devices being used as shock absorbers in buildings. New building designs and base isolation devices are tested here. The day we visited, this 9-square-foot shake table was being used. The computer-controlled hydraulic pistons shake and vibrate the table to simulate actual quakes based on seismographic recordings. But the really big experiments take place on this 20-by-20-foot, 50-ton concrete slab. In Berkeley, the testing continues as researchers look for new and better ways to protect the structures we build. But to the south, in Los Angeles County, they're installing the real thing. This may be one of the first places seismic isolators will be tested under real-life conditions. This is the new Los Angeles County Fire Command and Control Facility.
The isolator itself is attached to the vertical column, all one piece, delivered to the job site as one unit, and picked up by a crane and just dropped over the anchor bolts. And the workman screwed on the four nuts on top of it, and we were completed. So you'll be able to walk down below the underside of the building and actually see that the building is completely separated from the ground. It's fully supported on these rubber bearings.
It is imperative that this building remain functional even after the most devastating quake. After an earthquake, it is from here that Los Angeles County's emergency services will be dispatched. Fire trucks, ambulance and emergency medical service, rescue units.
I've got an idea that the people that are in this building in a major earthquake won't know they had an earthquake. And they may first learn about the earthquake when they begin to receive the call through the 911 system.
All along the San Andreas Fault, Californians are getting ready for the big one. But across the country, awareness is only just beginning to grow. Usually when people think of earthquakes, they think of the West Coast. But this isn't the Pacific Ocean. This is the Mississippi River. We came here because one of the largest quakes ever to hit North America struck right here. It was centered near what was at that time a thriving Mississippi River city, New Madrid, Missouri.
New Madrid was rocked by a series of several earthquakes. The first one was in December of 1811, December 16th. The biggest one was what is believed to be about an 8.7 or 8.8 on the Richter scale.
What did that do to the area?
Well, the town of New Madrid sunk about 15 feet, and with the high water, the river came in. The earth was said to move like waves. There's reports of waves of about 10 or 15 feet where the earth liquefies and just rolls like the ocean.
One of the most obvious results of the New Madrid earthquake is Real Foot Lake. Wildlife resource manager Paul Brown took us on a tour, covering over 15,000 acres where the lake now stands was once hardwood forest. Some stunted cypress are all that remains of that forest. Another surface feature that resulted from the quake of 1811 and 1812 is not quite as obvious.
If you stand here in this field, you can sort of vaguely see that there's a patch of sand that extends from that corner of the field towards us. And if you turn around, you can see that it heads off towards that corner of the field there.
The patches of sand seen clearly in this satellite photograph were formed by sand blows, geysers of sand mixed with water that shot up from the ground during the great quake.
Well, it turns out that there's a long line of patches of sand, linear patches of sand, depressions that are sometimes filled with water and other features that stretch for about 60 miles in this area.
Dr. Schweig and his assistants dug a 220-foot trench through the farmlands of eastern Missouri to enable them to study the phenomenon more clearly.
You see, there's this white sand, we call these dikes, dike of sand that squirted up towards the surface and apparently erupted onto the old surface. And you can also see that the old soil surface, that dark patch right beneath the sand that erupted out, is that it's been offset about a foot and a half. So everything on this side of that sand dike dropped down a foot and a half from everything on that side. So we suspect that this whole area between this eruption of sand and that eruption of sand formed in it was a zone in which the land on this side moved past the land on that side. And this may just be some sort of local feature. We don't have enough proof at this site yet to say absolutely this is a fault.
But on November 7th, 1989, Dr. Schweig made an announcement. He believes they've found one of the faults that caused the quakes of 1811 and 1812. But while the fault is quite real, getting people to understand the danger is another matter. Memphis, Tennessee, site of Beale Street, Elvis Presley's Graceland, and some of the best music America has to offer. It's also one of the sites in America most likely to be devastated by a major earthquake. City Council member Barbara Sonnenberg believes local building codes should include seismic design, and that has caused some controversy. The building at the center of this controversy is the Great American Pyramid, Memphis's new sports arena. It's destined to be a landmark. The Memphis City Council considered incorporating seismic protection into its design. They voted against it.
The big thing was money, and though I had some support on the City Council, I could not get enough. I was opposed very strongly by the administration, and just could not get enough votes to put in the extra $4 million. But this building's going to be used year-round and have crowds all the time, so I definitely feel that was an investment that should have been made.
And what are the odds of a major quake striking while a sports arena is full?
Mom, let's go!
It was the most unusual scene in World Series history.
When we return, San Francisco gets the chance to test its earthquake preparedness.
Excuse me,
yes.
Do you have a section on politics?
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking for a gift for my son. He's fascinated by it.
He'll love this. It's a bestseller.
You know, he loves to keep on top of science and technology.
Searching for the right gift can be so confusing. But the answer is as simple as Time. Give 52 issues of Time at 56% off the cover price. Three monthly installments of $14.99 each. Just call this number. Your gift of Time will arrive in a personalized holiday wrap, and we'll send you this card to announce it. Order now and get the Great Moments of the 60s video free with your paid subscription. From the Beatles and President Kennedy to a walk on the moon. Plus, you'll get Time's history of photojournalism when you make time for Time.
Would you like these gift wrap?
Oh, my. I can't get him all that. You've been very helpful, but I think I'll get him Time instead. It's the perfect gift.
Call 1-800-331-3343. This holiday season, make time for time.
In preparing this program, we'd intended to cover California in parts 1 and 2 and save discussion of the New Madrid Fault for this third part. But on October 17th at 5:04 p.m. Pacific Time, our plans changed. In Menlo Park, U.S. Geological Survey lost power immediately. Batteries helped, but it would be several hours until auxiliary power kicked in. Meanwhile, the rest of San Francisco had its own problems to deal with, and deal with them they did.
That's the San Francisco Fire Department calling all off-duty firefighters to come in to their duty station at once. These are live pictures coming in. You can see the freeway that's collapsed there near where that smoke is.
People in the Bay Area pulled together through what could have been their worst nightmare.
We have some good news to report, and that is the big fire in the marina is under control right now. And that's very, very good news.
Tell me what it was like here last night. Now, that had to be something really different from the fire.
Yeah, I mean, it was definitely the biggest earthquake I've ever been. I was sitting there at my Amiga, typing away, doing my work, and the first shock came through the P wave, presumably, and I thought, aha, magnitude 6, Lake Elsman, just like we had a month and a half ago. But then the S wave hit, and the building really started to shake, and I realized this was a lot bigger than that, or else it was an awful lot closer. So at that point, I got up, stood in the door frame, and watched the doors down the hall swinging back and forth. We start with a still frame right here of all 16 hours from 5 last evening to 9 this morning. All the aftershocks superimposed there, showing the segment of the fault that had failed. This is the 4 days leading up to it. No activity along the San Andreas till 5:04 last evening, and bang. And in the last 12, 14 hours, 16 hours, there's been nearly 2,000 aftershocks that have been recorded there.
Our immediate cause and the reason that we're here is to meet the emergency needs of these people. We get them into a shelter. We provide them nothing luxurious. It's a cot. It's a blanket. But it's a comfortable place to stay. It's a place to talk to Red Cross personnel and meals. So they're given the basics, the necessities, clothing, food, and a warm place to stay.
Consideration. We know that there's a number of buildings in there that are unsafe.
Can you hear it now?
Yeah.
All right. Now, what you will find out when you go there is the status of the building that you live in, that's in this area. It will have three statuses. One, okay, that it's all right to go back to under certain circumstances. Second one, limited access, which means that you can go back in there to get things. And third status will be no access because it is dangerous to you.
It could have been much worse. I think the horror pictures that we're all looking at are these overpasses that have come down, but let's take into account the way this freeway system is set up in this city and the hundreds and thousands of cars that are on these roads every day. Again, this was at rush hour. It was one of the most dangerous times that we felt an earthquake could hit. You have people all mobile. They were all in the process of moving around. Again, with the World Series going on, if there had been serious damage in that Coliseum, we don't even like to think about what it would have meant. It could have been much worse.
We're not going to save lives in Parkfield, I don't think, because nobody's ever been injured here. But if you go to the metropolitan areas, wow, the potential for doing something with information we might glean from Parkfield is just super.
Do you see this to be kind of a precedent that we catch on from here and more buildings, more and more and more will be built like this?
I sure hope so. It's a technology that theoretically has been around for years. And it's unfortunate that When you scale up a technology, the practitioners have a tough time accepting it.
Barbara, do you think the vote would have come out differently if you would have taken it this week?
Oh, I know it would have. The two mayors have come out with different types of statements saying that we absolutely have to have seismic design from now on, and they were not in favor of it originally. Some of the councilmen who opposed me the strongest have come out again also saying that they will now support seismic design in our new building code. So I don't wish an earthquake on anyone, but if there had to be one in San Francisco, I wish it had taken place about a year ago so we could have had all this change of heart then instead of right now. Then this building, which can hold 22,000 people, would have had seismic design and protection, some protection against earthquakes.
So it all comes down to this. How ready are we? How ready can we ever be? It's sort of a good news, bad news situation. The good news is seismologists had noted this stretch of the San Andreas Fault as a section most likely to experience an earthquake. They knew it was coming. That's the good news. The bad news is no one was able to warn the people of San Francisco. No one could say, take cover, it's coming now. Perhaps in the next few years, we'll be able to provide the same sort of warning we now provide for hurricanes, allowing people plenty of time to take cover or move to a place of safety. And eventually, someday, these buildings will be replaced with structures able to withstand the level of earthquakes common to this area. But no matter how far we advance, an earthquake will always be a frightening and awesome experience. We'll always be surprised at the amazing things our planet Earth can do. For the Weather Channel, I'm Cindy Preszler.
Discover Stouffer Presidente Breakations in Oaxaca, Cancun, Cozumel, Mexico City, Ixtapa, Los Cabos, Loreto. Our sun is hot. Our people are warm. Our locations are cool. Discover Stouffer Presidente Breakations and discover the magic of Mexico.
On Shaky Ground with Cindy Preszler will be seen again this evening at 11 o'clock. In just a minute, a look at this evening's weather, the good evening forecast, and our look ahead into this coming Friday. But first, your local forecast.
Weather Watch.
Charlie Welsh and Cindy Preszler, Sunday, December the 10th, and a cold week is forecast.
Very cold temperatures now. That frontal system is going to get into Oklahoma tonight. Still snowing in Kansas and Colorado. If you've been watching the Denver Bronco game, it's snowing over there.
No, I'm making plans to go to the Caribbean.
Oh, I agree.
Good idea.
Sure. Let's take a look at that weather tonight. Why is it snowing? Well, we do have that Arctic frontal system moving through. We've got an area of a low pressure trough coming down. A very cold high pressure center, that's coming down from the Yukon Territory of Canada.
Very cold temperatures, wind chill factors. Believe this one, 33 degrees below zero in Minot, North Dakota in the last hour. Snowing across North Dakota into South Dakota, down here across Kansas and Colorado. And we also have snow and cloud cover all the way into New York. Here's a look at the current surface map. This is the little frontal system that is bringing all that cold air down from Canada. Thank you very much. We don't want it, but here it is. All the snow associated with it. It will also set up those Santa Ana winds again coming up late tonight and into tomorrow. So you're going to be traveling through the passes and the valleys and canyons of Southern California. Look out for some very gusty winds. Snowfall potential will be quite heavy, and through Colorado you may get up to 12 inches. We've had quite a bit reported across South Dakota last night. Bring it all the way up into western New York State, Messina, Rome, Syracuse, New York. Here's a couple of spots for you. Winter picked up 11 inches of snow, picks down 6 inches all the way down to Denver, Colorado, still snowing over there. They've got at least 4 to 5 inches of snow on the ground down to Pierce, South Dakota. 2 inches of snow. That should be Pierce. I don't think that's supposed to be Pierce. I have to check on that. National radar, a little bit of snow showing up here in Iowa, so we've got a lot of that. And temperature-wise, not a bad one when you get into Texas, 73 degrees at Dallas. Oh, it's cold up here, though. 12 degrees at Bismarck, 0 at Great Falls, Montana with snow, but not bad along the coast, 62 degrees in L.A. Wind chill factors, very, very cold. We'll be right back. We'll take a look at that local forecast and then the rest of the week.
It's time for the Good Evening Forecast, which is sponsored by Rubbermaid, durable and dependable. Don't you wish everything was made like Rubbermaid? Early morning tomorrow, the nation is going to be pretty much in the icebox. Sunday is going to find, the rest of the day is going to find that cold air continuing to move south, and by Tuesday, being well in place of actually moving back to the west, back to the Southern California coast and down into Mexico by the time we get into Friday. What does that mean as far as precipitation is concerned? It means a lot of snow. Not heavy snow, but wide coverage, and even some freezing rain and sleet on to the south as this system starts to get us active again on the coast of Texas and working its way across the Gulf Coast. High pressure to the west, no big problems there, but very cold air just to the north of this frontal band. Temperatures are going to be getting into the 10 to 20 degree below zero range. The potential for precipitation, a tenth of an inch generally across the lakes into the northeast, the south, and across Texas and on into Colorado. Colorado will pick up about as much snow as anybody. They could get well over a foot of snow in the Continental Divide and into the Front Range, a good 6 to 12 inch snowfall. As a matter of fact, some places are approaching that even now. Temperatures in the morning hours tomorrow, 10 degrees below zero across the upper Plain States, the upper Mississippi Valley. Temperatures are going to be in the teens into the panhandle of Texas, into Chicago, and on over on to Detroit, as well as a good deal of New York back north into Maine. Now, the forecast highs for the day tomorrow don't look much like highs, because the only place where you're going to have any temperatures worth talking about, other than saying burr a lot, is from Chesapeake Bay to Florida, back down into Texas, and across the southwest. The rest of the nation, bitterly cold. Now, we can take a look ahead on through the rest of the week, right on into Friday. Here are the forecast highs for Tuesday. No major warming. As a matter of fact, more cold air sliding down across the plains. Some of this air is coming off of the ice cap, and back beyond that, Siberia is contributing to it, too. So you see, through Thursday, temperatures are going to be bitterly cold and stay that way right on into Friday. Plenty of precipitation. One batch of snow showers in the Rockies, strong winds in the Front Range, light snow for the upper Plain States. But here comes that storm from the south with rain, a mixture, and snow as it works on out very rapidly. That's going to be one of the best things about it, is that it's going to be moving rapidly, leaving light snow in the Rockies and into the plains and also into the Great Lakes region and to the northeast. A mixture across a good deal of Oklahoma, West Oklahoma, and the panhandle of Texas. Then here comes the next surge. Back along the Gulf Coast, a mixture in between, snow behind that, as we continue in a very wintry pattern. Now let's check in with Cindy.
Charlie, you used to have some of those thermal underwear with a little drawer in the back, mm-hmm. a little patch. If you have any of those, you'll need them. Temperatures are going to get cold this week. We'll take a look at the business travel forecast next.
Rubbermaid Serve and Saver food containers have the seal that never forgets to keep the bounce in your broccoli, the life in your lettuce, the pizzazz in your pretzels, the crunch in your carrots, the spin in your sprouts, the crisp in your crackers, and you can microwave reheat in them too. Serve and Savers keep the zing in almost everything. Don't you wish everything was made like Rubbermaid?
Whenever you come to Avis, we always have late model, well-equipped cars with great rates. No matter what the season or the holiday. Avis, we try harder to make it easier. When you buy a used car from Avis, you lock in something very important. Our good name. Avis, we try harder to make it easier, even in car sales.
Change this winter. Ski West Virginia.
Ski it, to believe it.
You'll never know till you try it.
You gotta ski it to believe it.
Skiing West Virginia is a welcome change. For more information, call 1-800-CALL-WVA.
The Nordica 997 Cup.
Nordica ski boots are available at these dealers.
And here's your business travel forecast.
Two out of three home fires start in the kitchen. Get the kitchen fire extinguisher from First Alert. It's specially designed for the kitchen. First Alert, because your family comes first.
Tickets for Webb.
We interrupt this purchase for a reminder. The Discover Card actually pays you cash back for every charge.
I hope you like this.
It pays to discover.
When you take a sinus medicine that can make you drowsy, it's like sleepwalking through your day. That's why there's Sudafed Sinus. It relieves sinus pain with a non-aspirin pain reliever and pressure with a decongestant that starts to work in as quick as 22 minutes without drowsiness. So if you don't want to sleepwalk through your day, get Sudafed Sinus. Fast sinus relief that won't put you fast asleep.
With all that snow falling tonight, you'll be able to slide all the way from Colorado into the Texas Panhandle. That's how far south the snow line will be. We'll take a look at a traveler's update coming up.
Some holiday gifts go right into storage, and some go right to work. Like this Master Mechanic 3/8-inch cordless drill and screwdriver from True Value Hardware Stores. It delivers 230 RPM and can work anywhere. Plus, it recharges in just 3 hours, and it's only $19.99 at these participating True Value Hardware Stores and Home Center.
Brought to you exclusively by participating True Value Hardware Stores and Home Centers. Visit your local True Value store.
Time for the Traveler's Update, sponsored by Phillips Super Clean Unleaded Gasoline. Good things for cars and the people who drive them.
Apparently, people are beginning to think that stopping here is a good thing to do, because more people are coming here than ever before. Our high-detergent, super-clean, unleaded gasolines might be one reason. Or maybe it's that cash or credit are the same low price. Whatever it is, we'd like for you to stop by, too. Who knows? You may find your own reason.
Traveling, here's our national radar. It doesn't tell the whole story, though. It's snowing back across Nebraska and into Colorado. And as Cindy indicated, a lot of that snow is going to start working south during the nighttime hours. But national radar is picking up snow in Iowa and back into the northern parts of Illinois. There's an upper-level low working across there, the same one that dropped a lot of snow on Nebraska and southern parts of South Dakota during the day today. So wintry travel is widespread from northern Illinois and southern parts of Wisconsin on across deep into the Rockies and back north all the way into the Canadian Rockies. This is a very cold batch of air, and it's creating its own snow because it's so cold. It's wringing whatever moisture there is right out of the air. Windy travel, too, as that front drops onto the south. Some places in Kansas, Colorado, back into Oklahoma, are getting winds out of the north now at 30 to 35 miles an hour. And Guadalupe Pass in Texas is primed for 50-mile-an-hour winds, while winds coming from the east across Southern California will continue to blow across the Great Basin and into Southern California. Now stay tuned for your local forecast.
Welcome to the world of government auctions. Did you know that the United States government wants to sell you cars, boats, homes, and real estate at bargain prices? In some cases, they're selling things at prices so low you'd think that they're practically giving everything away. They have cars, boats, office equipment, and homes seized from drug dealers. The government has homes and real estate they want you to buy. Do you want any of these bargains? Call now and find out what you can get right here in your area. Federal, state, and local government agencies want you to come to their auctions. And now you can find out about all of these auctions and more by getting your copy of the Action Guide to Government Auctions. Do you want a car, a boat, a home, office equipment? Call right now and find out what's available. One man went to a government auction and bought a $50,000 boat seized from drug dealers, and he paid only $10. Get your copy right now. Operators are standing by to take your order and to tell you what's available in your area. Call 1-800-822-2470. That's 1-800-822-2470.
Thank you.
those winds are blowing out of the north at 20 to 30 miles an hour, anywhere from North Dakota all the way into Kansas. And once that front makes it through farther to the south into Oklahoma and Texas, we can expect the same type of situation. Blowing and drifting snow, 1 to 3 inches in through central Oklahoma, down into Texas, all the way into the plains of Texas as well. This frontal system is going way down there into Texas. National radar is picking up some of the snow down here into Illinois, back into Iowa, Nebraska. Not showing up very well, but it is snowing down into the Denver area. It has been snowing all day long. Temperatures are cold, too, to support that snow. 12 degrees at Bismarck, however, the wind chill factor is way below that. We've got 16 degrees in Omaha and snow. 72 in El Paso, Texas. Beautiful out on the west coast. No problems there. The Santa Anas will be starting up tonight. And out to the east, 33 degrees in New York City. They've got a pretty nice day in store again tomorrow for those folks. And 47 degrees in Atlanta, Georgia. It was a beautiful day in the southeast today. Now for the rest of the winter update, here's Charlie.
You know, it's 11 days still until December yields the season of winter, 21st of December. But here we are, and we have been now for quite a few days, talking about winter storm updates. I don't know what else you could call them. It's very, very cold, very, very snowy. There's the snow since this morning across the plains and into the front range of the Rockies. Winter, South Dakota. Is that near Minot? 11 inches, not near Minot. 11 inches of snow. Rye, Colorado's had 6. Rye is propensity for getting a lot of snow. Hurley, Wisconsin's had 3 inches of snow. The potential is for Colorado to be hardest hit, but back down into Raton Pass, too, you could run into a 6 to 12-inch snowfall. But in the Continental Divide in Colorado, a good foot of snow could fall, 1 to 3 across the lakes as that upper-level system zips across through there. Now, the potential for wintry travel is, again, widespread from Illinois in through the Continental Divide and north into Canada, right on through overnight the Southern Lakes region into the Mississippi Valley, and from Wyoming south into the panhandle of Texas, and hanging in there through the day tomorrow while the lakes get another dusting of snow. That's the way it looks at the moment. We have got your local forecast coming along. As a matter of fact, I think I see it on the horizon right now.
You'll have a pretty nice Monday, but to the north there is some scattered snow showers in the area as today, and it will be again tomorrow the way it looks, all the way into Maine, down here across western New York, and back into the Great Lakes states as well. Tonight, dipping to 21 degrees at Buffalo, 23 at Boston. Look for 23 degrees also in the Portland area, down to 25 at Washington tomorrow, into the 20s, 30s, 43 in the nation's capital. Southeast will have another nice day, kind of. Temperatures are going to be cooling off, though, but we'll keep the snow line way to the north. Down south, though, into Florida, it's going to look pretty nice, partly cloudy skies. 51 degrees in New Orleans tonight, Tampa 47, 32 at Dallas, Fort Worth, and Memphis. Tomorrow, look for 40 there, 36 at Dallas, 54 in Houston, 57 degrees in Atlanta, Georgia. Plain states, you have to deal with the snow, plenty of it too. That snow line is coming along that Arctic frontal system. We're getting that lake effect snow across Lake Superior. So right in through there, the snow belt, you could get quite a bit of snow, maybe up to 6 inches. Drop that across Illinois into Missouri and way down there into Texas, as a matter of fact. Below zero across North Dakota and Minnesota tonight, and that's straight temperature. That does not include the wind chill. It gets down to about 30 degrees, 30 to 40 degrees below zero. 15 at Chicago, 23 at Indianapolis. Tomorrow into the 20s and teens, 12 at Omaha, and a mere 3 degrees in Bismarck. Very cold. West Coast, Santa Ana winds in Southern California, gusty out of the northeast, gusting up to 35, maybe 50 mile per hour winds. Be very careful, especially along the Cajon Pass down there. Snow will be falling again into the Denver area and south into New Mexico, also into the northern spots of Arizona. 32 degrees at Portland, 32 at Seattle tonight, 3 degrees below zero at Billings. Tomorrow, look for 80 in Los Angeles, 60 in Phoenix, and 21 in Denver with snow on the ground. We'll be back.
I was putting in a lot of late hours at the office. The pressure was really getting to me. My doctor told me if I didn't get some exercise, I'd be a prime candidate for a heart attack.
Nordic Track.
I had a terrible time losing weight after my second baby.
and dieting wasn't enough.
Nordic Track.
I really wanted to enjoy this time with my grandson, but I didn't have the energy to keep up.
Nordic Track duplicates cross-country skiing. It tones, develops, and conditions all the major muscles of your upper and lower body. Independent research shows users prefer Nordic Track more than 6-to-1 over exercise bikes and rowing machines. So it's a great way to get in shape, manage stress, and help control weight.
Nordic Track was just what I needed to work off stress.
With Nordic Track, I was able to lose weight and still eat regular meals.
Now I've got more pep.
For complete details on Nordic Track, call 1-800-432-9900. That's 1-800-432-9900.
Time for the Michelin Drivers Report. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires. Wintry travel across the plains, and it is getting worse because the snow is continuing to fall. Particularly heavy snow is falling in the eastern parts of Colorado, but the snow is being felt all the way east into the northern parts of Illinois. So I-80 and I-70 could be two problem areas for you. Here's the whole widespread picture. UP of Michigan picking up some snow, but this one from west, just west of the lakes, all the way through the Continental Divide and north into Canada, including the Uintas in Utah, is a pretty wintry travel scene. Windy travel problems, too, across the plains. Some of the winds from the north behind this front as it whirls on down with the cold air are running 30, 35 miles an hour, and temperatures are dropping like a rock. Guadalupe Pass, 50-mile-an-hour winds the story there. On back into the western parts of Colorado, on up into Montana, from the Four Corners area right on across the Great Basin to Southern California, winds from the east are whipping across.
I'm ready for one thing when I drive. Everything. Bad weather, bad drivers. Michelins are for all the things that can't possibly happen, but always do. Am I overprotective? I've got reason to be. The way I see it, you never need a Michelin until you really need a Michelin.
Michelin, because so much is riding on your tires.
Find Michelin tires at this dealer near you, because so much is riding on your tires.
Stay tuned for this evening's weather, coming up right after your local forecast.
Snowy travel on radar, and boy, quite a lot of it, too. And here's Cindy Preszler.
That's right, Charlie, but the radar is not picking it up very well. Snow is a tough time being picked up on radar. It just doesn't have a lot of reflectivity. However, it is snowing from Montana to North Dakota, South Dakota, Nebraska, Colorado, Wyoming, all the way into Kansas, and eventually that line will be moving on to the south into Oklahoma and Texas. Snow also falling into Peoria, Illinois. You could follow it across Michigan into western New York, Utica, Rome, New York, all picking up some snow at this time. Let's focus in on a little area here. From Des Moines, Iowa, over towards the Ottumwa, Iowa area, and then into Illinois, Peoria, all the way down towards, look at that, Kansas City is going to get some snow very shortly, and drop that down across Russell, Kansas, and farther on to the south, eventually getting into Oklahoma City. We're expecting very cold temperatures tonight, blowing and drifting snow, and that line will drop south with the Arctic cold front. We'll be back with more weather.
Welcome to Sunday's Prime Time Tonight, your three-minute guide to cable television, coming to you every half hour during your primetime viewing hours. movies are coming your way. USA has The Swarm, a disaster film starring Michael Caine and Catherine Ross. The Disney Channel presents Million Dollar Mermaid. TBS has Monty Walsh with Lee Marvin and Jack Palance. Next on Disney, Esther Williams stars in Million Dollar Mermaid, a true story featuring water ballet by Busby Berkeley.
Here she is, introducing Australia's Annette Talbot.
The dramatic programs and comedy specials. The Family Channel brings you Rin Tin Tin, Canine Cop. On the Discovery Channel is The Nature of Things. Nickelodeon presents Inspector Gadget. TNT brings you Cousteau, Lost Relics of the Sea. A&E presents Wings Over the World. Next on Nickelodeon, the intrepid Inspector Gadget applies his genius to the never-ending battle against M.A.D.
Report.
Everything A-OK. Only Gadget keeps me from flying that ship. And I know how to take care of him.
Here are the sports coming this half hour. ESPN brings you NFL primetime. On TNN, American Sports Cavalcade highlights racing action from pro stock to drag strip. In just a few minutes, check out ESPN for an inside look at your favorite teams on NFL primetime. News and the latest weather. CNN presents Newswatch. Lifetime has cardiology update for physicians. On the Weather Channel is your local forecast. Headline News brings you the history-making stories of our time. Later tonight, the Weather Channel brings you current and forecast highway conditions on the Michelin Driver's Report. Now, here's a recap of the shows coming up in just a few moments. Primetime Tonight. We'll be back in 27 minutes with more cable TV highlights.